graphic audio. A movie in your mind.
India, August 1667. City of Golconda, Hindu temple to the blessed Sita. Darkness is a thief's best friend, but his greatest ally is a storm. In this case, a monsoon. Darkness will cloak the actions of the most expert of thieves, one who is practiced in the arts of stealth and patience. But a storm will mask the mistakes of even the clumsiest of amateurs. A shadow moved quickly across the floor of the temple as the lightning faded. The shadow, not quite 4 feet high, leapt onto the altar and began to climb the statue of the god Rama's beloved wife. Varun had been orphaned early. His father had died in a mining accident before he was born, and his mother, never a strong woman, breathed her last breath as he drew his first. Eventually, he ended up on the streets, as none of his relatives had the resources to feed another hungry mouth. So, at the age of 10, and for all intents and purposes a man, he made a living from handouts and petty thievery. Tonight, he would make the move from petty thief to jewel thief. The statue of Sita sat upon the altar, towering 10 feet above the stone floor. Unlike her blue-hued love Rama, Sita was painted orange. Her smiling face was framed by a golden crown. It wasn't the gold which had brought Varun to the temple that night. It was her eyes. He held onto the neck of the statue using his legs and struggled to draw the small knife he had been able to steal for a specific purpose. He began to dig at the stone which surrounded one of her beautiful eyes. Those were nothing short of magic. Two diamonds of amazing size and clarity, one blue, one green, had been set in Sita's eyes. The stones, when lit by torchlight, would glitter and bring the statue to life. Worshippers would feel those eyes gazing upon them, and feel the love of Sita fill their hearts and minds, making lonely women and men believe that they would someday know that love, which seemed the provenance of gods, in their own ordinary lives.
Ah!
But that meant nothing to a hungry street kid like Varun. All he saw was opportunity. The first stone free, he dropped it carefully into a sack on his belt and began to work on the second, larger eye. The white man who had visited the marketplace had promised a great reward to anyone who could bring him jewels. Varun had watched as the miners approached the large man with the strange accent, hoping the jewels they brought would fetch a hefty price. The man rejected stone after stone. The few stones he did buy were the largest and most flawless. Varun knew of only two stones which would meet the foreigner's critical eye, and he set out to get them before the stranger left the village the next morning. He had snuck in early that morning with the usual temple-goers and found a place between a pillar and a wall where he could crouch without being noticed. It was uncomfortable, and he had forgotten to bring water. The air was thick with moisture as the impending storm grew closer and closer. Finally, worshippers and temple priests alike had gone to their homes for the night, leaving Varun alone with the shadows, the storm, and the eyes of Sita. Having finally freed the second eye, he scampered down the statue quickly and ran across the floor, no longer worried about being heard, but now intent on leaving the temple with his prize.
Graphic Audio presents Rogue Angel by Alex Archer. Narrated by Nanette Savard. With performances by Colleen Delany, Tim Getman, Lily Beacon, James Lewis, Tracy Olivera, Carolyn Kashner, Peter Holdway, Zeke Alton, Richard Rowan, Laura C. Harris, Terence Aselford, Bradley Smith, Ken Jackson, Kimberly Gilbert, Michael John Casey, Todd Scofield, and Scott McCormick. Rogue Angel number 59, Eyes of the Beholder.
Mesdames and messieurs, we have now started our approach into Montreal Pierre Trudeau International Airport. Local temperature is -1 Celsius, that's 30 degrees Fahrenheit for our American visitors, with light winds and light snow showers. In other words, another balmy January day in the province of Quebec. We will be arriving just after 1:30 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. We ask that you remain in your seats until the plane has arrived at the terminal and the fasten seatbelt sign has been turned off. On behalf of your Montreal-based flight crew and myself, please enjoy your visit to Canada.
Yesterday it was 83 degrees. This better be worth it, Doug.
It had been several months since Annja Creed had been called upon to host a segment of Chasing History's Monsters. She had literally been neck-deep in a dig site in the Yucatan for 4 months, excavating a pre-Aztec burial mound when she received the call from her producer, Doug Morrell.
It will be, I promise. A tribe of French-Canadian werewolves terrorizing the Montreal suburbs. What could be better than that?
This was the first thing that struck Annja as odd about this assignment. Werewolf myths, Canadian or not, were a dime a dozen. Every culture had their own version of men turning into wolves, either with or without the aid of the full moon. Annja had pitched a similar story about Estonian werewolves last year and had been met with an emphatic, no more werewolves. But here they were, looking for suburban lycanthropes, less than a one-hour flight from her apartment in New York.
I'm sorry I had to drag you away from your dig in Chihuahua.
Yucatan.
Right, Yucatan. I got you your bonus. We are booked into that shoebox of a hotel you requested in the old city, and I promise you we'll be in and out in 4 days, 5 days max, so you can get back to your dead Mexicans.
The second warning that something was afoot. Doug had never been so invested in whether Annja went into the field or not. For Annja, the basic cable show was a means to fund her real passion for archaeological fieldwork. At the moment, the cost of her fieldwork was being covered by a grant by the Universidad Nacional Autónoma de México. So the usual motivating factor for Annja, money, to be at Doug's beck and call, was not as pressing as usual.
So what are you doing here? You never go into the field.
Bosses have been breathing down my neck to actually do some producing. They claim that people are starting to complain that my historical recreations are relying too heavily on green screens, close-ups, and ridiculous-looking wigs. So, my choice was a one-hour flight to the Great White North or 24-hour flight to New Zealand in search of a giant eel with poisonous blood.
I'm not buying it.
You're always complaining that I don't give you the support that you need in the field, that I don't understand the historical context of these monsters. So, here I am, fully contextualized and ready to understand.
Who are you and what have you done with my producer?
As the landing gear deployed on the small commuter jet, Annja looked out the window onto the suburbs of Montreal. The ground was covered with snow, but the Canadians, no strangers to frozen precipitation, had carefully cleared every sidewalk, boulevard, and alleyway, creating a checkerboard of white squares and rectangles on the ground below.
Annja, I need you to trust me, okay?
I'll trust you. Until I can't anymore.
Allô?
They have arrived in Montreal.
Merci. You will let me know when they've arrived at the hotel.
Oui, madame.
The fast food restaurants and big box stores whipped by the taxi window. Doug and Annja hadn't exchanged a pleasant word since the plane touchdown. Despite the black cloud hanging over her return to Montreal, Annja couldn't help but be happy to be back in La Ville aux 100 Clochers, the City of 100 Steeples, so named for the numerous churches that made up the city's skyline. When Annja spent her first year at school in New York, She was hard-pressed to leave the city. The desire to wander the world was already burning bright in her heart, but with little money, spring break in Paris was out of reach. But there was a slice of Europe quite close by, the Canadian province of Quebec. An 8-hour drive from New York, the cities of Montreal and Quebec City were a cheap way for Annja to practice her French and her travel skills before making her way to Europe. Quebec City was the more European of the two, with its narrow streets and citadel overlooking the St. Lawrence River. Montreal was more of a hybrid, Baltimore mashed up with the Marais neighborhood in Paris. There was a college town atmosphere, bars and bawdy nightlife, a great match for a young Annja Creed looking to push boundaries and take controlled risks. Her one miscalculation had been in thinking that just because it was spring in New York, meant it was spring in Montreal. On her second day, a foot of snow fell in the span of 4 hours.
Arrêtez-vous ici, s'il vous plaît.
Doug paid the cabbie and left a generous tip, which he could expense, of course. Their packs were awkward and overstuffed with winter gear. They were in the oldest section of the city, near the Cathedral de Notre Dame. The streets were narrow and paved with cobblestones. The streets around the cathedral were surrounded by a mixture of pricey restaurants, kitschy gift shops, erotic Asian art galleries, and sex toy shops. Despite the split personality of the neighborhood, somehow it worked. The sacred and the profane living in harmony. Annja had selected the boutique hotel La Pucelle d'Orléans, the Maid of Orleans, for two reasons. First, she wanted to avoid the high-rise hotels of downtown Montreal, with their characterless rooms and their overly soft mattresses. Second, she could never quite resist a wink and a nod to her mystical connection with Joan of Arc. The unassuming four-story building, with its glass-fronted lobby, reminded Annja of hotels all over France. The cozy lobby was empty. A too-large sofa almost filled the room, leaving just enough space for Doug and Annja to cross to the front desk. A set of cubbies with room numbers and keys sat on the wall behind the waist-high desk.
Bonjour!
From an office to the left of the desk emerged a tiny woman. She could have been 60 or she could have been 100. Her lavender hair was piled like fluffy meringue over a white porcelain face, which seemed to have been pulled too tightly across her skull. She pulled a drag on a comically large vape machine, which she put down on the counter. She adjusted a very tight short skirt and perched on a stool behind the counter.
Salut.
Salut. I believe you have two reservations, one for Creed and another for Morel.
With the American television people. We have been expecting you, of course. We don't see many Americans in January. They don't like snow. I have placed you on the third floor, in adjoining rooms. There is no hot water after 10 at night. We have no elevator, and the bellboy is on his lunch break. I would help you, but I don't go upstairs since the incident. Checkout is at 11. Sign here, please. And here. Merci. If you have any problems, I am Natalie, and I am always here. The stairs are to the left.
Merci.
Oh, and one more thing. Don't go up to the fourth floor. We have had to close that floor for repairs.
The lack of hot water after 10 would have been a hardship for many, but any hot water was an improvement over the lukewarm showers she had endured for the last 4 months on the Yucatan Peninsula. One begins to resent sharing a solar shower with a half dozen grad students while avoiding the strafing runs of mosquitoes as large as your palm, while trying to rinse off the slimy residue of soap with water so hard you could polish it. The water at La Pucelle d'Orléans was hot, soft, and there was plenty of it. Annja even indulged in the rare luxury of conditioning her long chestnut hair. She had arrived at her Brooklyn apartment the day before with just enough time to pack a knapsack and check her mail before being whisked to the airport by an uncharacteristically involved Doug. Despite the dire warnings from Natalie at the front desk, the room was comfortable, if a bit cozy. It had a very 1950s charm, with narrow twin beds covered by downy comforters. A vintage Bakelite clock radio sat on the table between them. The bathroom was a cheery pink, with separate faucets for the hot and cold water. The room probably hadn't seen a renovation since the first Trudeau administration, and could have benefited from a dusting, but it was warm and exactly what Annja wanted.
Some things never change.
The music on Montreal radio continued to be a mix of modern French pop music and 1980s American soft rock. Nothing threatening like heavy metal, but the best of Guns N' Roses and Duran Duran were in heavy rotation in elevators, malls, and taxicabs all over the city. Annja wrapped a paper-thin towel around her hair and slipped into a pair of workout pants and a tank top. She still had an hour before she was going to meet Doug for dinner at a local steakhouse, and while a nap was tempting, she decided it might move things along if she looked over the research on the Le Loup-Garou before their meeting. She took the large file folder from her pack and laid the contents on the bed covers and sat cross-legged on the bed. Chasing History's monsters had done a half dozen werewolf legends over the years, and all of them shared similar elements of fantasy and psychology. The phenomenon of lycanthropy, men and women exhibiting the behavior of a wolf or wild animal, had been well documented since the 19th century. Le Loup-Garou had a uniquely Catholic twist. These men, who turned into wolves, were being punished for having failed to attend church at Easter for 7 contiguous years. And while becoming a wolf was the most common punishment for the lapse, men were also known to transform into pigs, oxen, cats, and in rare cases, even a snowy owl. The research mentioned a few sightings of the man-wolves in the Montreal suburbs, but nothing since the late 80s. She had to admit that the story did have fascinating cultural and religious overtones, but she was not sure why this investigation was so pressing, and she certainly had no idea why Doug had seen fit to actually accompany her into the field.
Hello? Yeah, we're here. This famous sister doesn't know what's going on. Let me speak to her.
While she couldn't make out the words, she could sense the mood of Doug's phone call bleeding through the wall. Something was wrong, that was obvious.
What's going on, Doug?
Keep to the plan, Monsieur Morel, and matters will be resolved in due course. Bring Annja Cree to the arranged meeting place, and you'll have nothing to worry about.
I can't keep lying to her. I'm no good at it, and she knows me too well.
This will soon be over, but if you can't keep your end of the bargain, you know the consequences.
Oui, madame.
Renee, bring the car around. It's time to meet Annja Cree.
A light snow had begun to fall. The few cars on the narrow streets carefully made their way around potholes that could swallow one of the smaller cars whole. Doug had been waiting in the lobby for Annja, bundled for the Iditarod instead of the mild winter night that greeted them. Sometimes you had to beg Doug to slow down so you might get a word in edgewise, but not tonight.
How close is the restaurant?
A couple of blocks.
Look, Doug, I know you don't like being away from New York, and we don't always get along, which is probably my fault. Well, at least some of the time. If I've done anything to upset you, I'd like to think we've known each other long enough that we can talk things out. What's going on? You aren't acting like, well, you.
I'm not sure what you mean. Am I stressed? Sure, but I'm fine. Just not, like you said, used to this kind of thing. I should be back in the Big Apple, not cruising the Canadian equivalent of Williamsburg. Just give me a day to get acclimated, and I swear we'll knock this out, and you'll be back sweating your shorts off in the Mexican jungle before you know it. Please, Annja, I need you to believe me. Everything is gonna be fine.
Okay. But just remember that you can trust me.
I know. All right, you ready for that steak I promised you? Apparently, it's au poivre. That's good, right?
Oh, yes. If they have creamed spinach, you might get lucky tonight.
Really?
No.
Miss Creed, please come with me.
The voice came from a narrow alleyway. A man took a step forward out of the darkness, holding what appeared to be a compact military taser.
Come with you where? Who are you?
My employer will answer your questions when you meet. And before you get any ideas about trying to escape, my colleague is watching from above and he has a weapon which could do far more damage than this taser.
When you put it that way, I guess I'm meeting your employer.
Please step into the limousine, Miss Creed. Slowly.
Annja, I'm sorry!
Annja sat on the bench seat facing the back of the limo, and before she could turn and ask Doug what the hell was going on, she was watching his silhouette recede into the darkness as the limo carried her away.
Huh.
The interior lights came on, blinding Annja for a moment. Her eyes adjusted, and she got her first view of her host.
Bonsoir, Mademoiselle Creed. May I call you Annja? I feel as though I know you already.
She was a tall woman. You could see that even as she lounged on the limo's deep leather seat. She appeared to be in her early 30s, but Annja knew money and a good plastic surgeon could throw that estimate off by 10 or 15 years. She was striking, which wasn't a word Annja used often. Her piercing violet eyes reminded her of a young Elizabeth Taylor, yet where Liz's eyes conveyed vulnerability and sex, this woman's eyes conveyed cunning and an iron will.
You can call me anything you want, but first tell me what the hell I'm doing here.
He told me you would be all business. And he also told me to never underestimate you. So before you pull one of your incredible escapes from a moving vehicle, you should know that Monsieur Morel is being held until our business is completed.
It'll be hard to conduct business when we haven't been properly introduced.
I am sorry. You are right. It is my hope that we will overcome the awkwardness of this introduction and become fast friends. You'll find that I can be a very good friend to you, Annja. This meeting will benefit both of us.
Still didn't catch your name.
Pardon. I am Antoinette Leroy. I know it sounds like the name of a 1970s Bond villain, but my mother had a flair for the theatrical. She also had a terrible problem with addiction and a taste for the worst kind of men. Fortunately, I only inherited two of those traits. Drink?
No.
Down to business, then. I have a job for a woman with your skill set and talents. If successful, you will be well compensated for your troubles.
Okay. I don't think I've ever been offered a job during a kidnapping, but go on.
Let me tell you a story. There are many versions, and I've done much research on this subject down the years, but I'm going to tell it to you the way my grandmère told it to me. You are an historian, so I shall not get bogged down in historical details. Most people assume that as soon as the revolution began in France in 1789, Fat King Louis and the fatuous Marie Antoinette were the first ones to have their heads removed. I'm sure you are aware that this was not so. The angry mobs didn't get around to introducing them to Madame Guillotine until the fall of 1791.
Your grand-mère had a flair for storytelling.
Yes, as I was saying, Marie and Louis had 2 years to plan an exit strategy. But how would they support themselves in exile? How could they transport liquid capital out of the country without Robespierre and his bloodthirsty army of pissed-off peasants getting wind of it? So, Marie chose her most loyal maid, Agnes, and loaded the young girl down with some of the choicest of the French crown jewels, with instructions to take them to the former French colonial town of Louisbourg on Cap-Breton, just north of here. Then she was to wait for the arrival of her queen. Somehow, Young Agnes escaped the Paris mobs and made her way across the English Channel. In England, she sold one of the gems in order to buy passage to the colonies. Finally, after a long, arduous journey, she arrived in Louisbourg, where she waited and waited for news of her beloved queen. We know now that the news, when it came, was not good. Now, what is a poor French servant girl to do? A woman alone, a stranger in a strange land, with a king's ransom hidden away? Pardon, this is thirsty work. Where was I? Oh, yes. One would think that Agnes, now safe from the revolution, would sell the jewels and live like a queen herself. But apparently, her loyalty to her mistress ran incredibly deep. Instead of buying the biggest house in Quebec, she found herself a nice French soldier, had a brood of children, and then faded into obscurity. And the story of Louis and Marie's fabulous treasure was handed down through the next 2 centuries until it became little more than a fairy tale.
And now you want me to find these crown jewels?
No, Annja. I want you to help keep the jewels lost.
Madame Roy, I am an archaeologist. My job is to find things, not to lose them.
I am well aware of your profession, and I am aware of your numerous extracurricular adventures as well. I am a contractor for the Service Canadien de Renseignement de Sécurité.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.